Blackstone Audio presents Give Me Liberty, Speakers and Speeches That Have Shaped America by Christopher L. Weber. This book is read by Jim Manchester. This book is dedicated with love and thankfulness to Peg for giving me the freedom to write, indeed the ability to live in freedom. Foreword. Defining freedom. Give me liberty, demanded Patrick Henry as he held up his right arm and flourished an ivory letter opener. Or give me death. Bringing the point of the letter opener down to his chest, he collapsed dramatically into his chair. Visual aids can sometimes help get our attention, and they may have done so on that day, just over 2 years before July 4th. 1776. Today, however, Patrick Henry's letter opener has been largely forgotten. One witness apparently failed to notice it in the first place and remembered only a gesture with his hands, while his words continue to echo in American history, and the speech remains one of the two or three known to almost every American. There are only a few speeches that most Americans remember, and all of them have to do with liberty. They seem to trace a rising arc of understanding, of broadening and clarifying the definition of liberty, a word that remains a central value in American life and is stamped on every United States coin in circulation. But what exactly is liberty? There seems to be a wide range of opinion, and seldom have the ends of that range spread further apart than today. In Patrick Henry's day, it was simple enough to think in terms of freedom from a foreign government's control of one's life. But now, a variety of forces impact our lives in various ways, and freeing ourselves from one may make us more vulnerable to another. Sometimes we are eager to work for measures that seem to increase our own freedom without thinking or caring that they may limit the freedom of others who are seeking other goals, goals that may seem to us wrong-headed or even immoral, as ours may seem to them. Questions about the meaning of freedom seem to rise up daily to challenge us. What limits, if any, should government place on our freedom to marry whom we choose, or to purchase whatever weapons we want, or smoke cigarettes or marijuana, or cut down a tree or drain a swamp? Should American freedom include immigrants who arrive without documentation? Should American resources be used in an attempt to expand the freedom of those living elsewhere under oppressive regimes? The questions are endless, and no two people are likely to give the same answers to all of them. It is, however, questions like these that Americans have worked to resolve, sometimes peacefully, and sometimes with great violence over the span of our history. Perhaps uniquely among the nations of the world, the United States traces its origins to groups and individuals who came specifically to create something new. For some of those who came, that something new was simply an escape from economic or political or religious oppression. For some, it was as simple as better farmland or economic opportunity for themselves. For still others, however, it was a society organized around specific, clearly stated principles. For all of them, the land that would become the United States of America represented freedom, freedom from the economic or political or religious or social systems they had known, and freedom to live in a new way, however they might define it. Canadians and Australians and others might claim a similar history. But at one dramatic point in their past, Americans fought a war demanding freedom and created a constitution to define and protect the freedom they envisioned. Freedom, then, became a unifying principle in a unique way. But still, it was defined so differently by various individuals and groups that Americans have been arguing ever since as to what freedom truly means and what it should look like. Among the most important groups who came were the Puritans and Pilgrims who began the settlement of the New England states. They came to be free of a church that was deeply offensive to them, and to be able to create a new society based on their own principles. As their ships neared the New England coast, their leader, John Winthrop, preached a sermon in which he highlighted a further dimension of the American experiment in freedom. "We must consider," he said, "that we shall be as a city upon a hill. The eyes of all people are upon us." Not only were the colonists creating a new society for themselves, but they were embarking on an experiment that would be watched, for better or worse, by others. Some who would hope to see it fail, and some who would hope to see it succeed, and so establish a model for themselves as well. Winthrop's words would be remembered and cited by two American presidents, John F. Kennedy and Ronald Reagan, more than three centuries later. Reagan would cite it often and add the word shining to make it a shining city on a hill. Winthrop's words would also take flesh as American presidents spoke in Berlin and Cairo and Beijing and Moscow and Cape Town and were listened to as bearing witness to an ideal which, however poorly it may be realized in some respects in the United States, remains a hope that inspires millions living under tyranny. In the time since John Winthrop spoke, ordinary Americans have been at work building the imagined city. Some have shared his vision very specifically, while others have had different dreams or none that they could articulate. Together, they have created a working society in which freedom, variously defined and understood, has remained a central value. Along the way, there have been many who have expressed the vision in their own words, drawing on their own experience and responding as well to new challenges and changing times and circumstances. Some of these have used words that seemed so appropriate that they have been remembered and quoted and held up to inspire others. The effort to define freedom continues today and is reported almost daily in the media. John Winthrop is cited still, and so are Abraham Lincoln and Ronald Reagan and Martin Luther King Jr. and others. Their words do remain relevant, yet our circumstances continue to change, and the definition of freedom, if it is to be useful, must continue to be expressed in new ways. As we struggle to find ways to define.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.